Great is thy faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the worship experience of the Tierra Santa Seventh-day Adventist Church, located in San Diego, California. We're in my living room, the McCary home in San Marcos, California, about 25 miles north of Tierra Santa. We have been doing this service from my living room for almost a year now. Hard to believe, but that's what it's been. And some of you have been along every single Sabbath during this year, and others are just joining perhaps for the first time today. And we welcome you and thank you for joining us and hope that this will be an inspiring and enlightening few minutes for you as you worship with us today. I'm going to sing a couple of songs in addition to the one that I just sang. I always begin with Great is Thy Faithfulness because that is my theme regarding the character of God. God is faithful and loving. There's a little song that was put together a few years ago. It's a Scottish Psalter of the 23rd Psalm. So it has all of the verses of the 23rd Psalm, but in a Scottish way. And the first stanza, for example, says, "The Lord's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me down to lie. In pastures green he leadeth me, the quiet waters by." This is the Lord's my shepherd, Scottish version. My shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me down to lie. In pastures green he leadeth me, the quiet waters by. He leadeth me, the quiet waters by. My soul he doth restore again, and me to walk doth make. Within the paths of righteousness, e'en for his own name's sake. Within the paths of righteousness, even for his own name's sake. Yea, though I walk in death's dark vale, yet will I fear no ill. For thou art with me, and thy rod and staff me comfort still. For thou art with me, and thy rod and staff me comfort still. My table thou hast furnished in presence of my foes. My head thou dost with oil anoint, and my cup overflows. My head thou dost with oil anoint, and my cup overflows. Goodness and mercy all my life shall surely follow me, and in God's house forevermore my dwelling place shall be. And in God's house forevermore my dwelling place shall be. Lovely version of the 23rd Psalm. The last verse, of course, and the last line of the last verse is so comforting to us with a promise. And in God's house forevermore our dwelling place shall be. So I'd like to sing for you now a wonderful spiritual entitled, There'll Be No Dark Valley. There'll be no dark valley when Jesus comes. There'll be no dark valley when Jesus comes. There'll be no dark valley when Jesus comes to gather his loved ones home. To gather his loved ones home. To gather his loved ones home. There'll be no dark valley when Jesus comes to gather his loved ones home. There'll be no more sorrow when Jesus comes. There'll be no more sorrow when Jesus comes. There'll be no more sorrow when Jesus comes to gather his loved ones home. To gather his loved ones home. To gather his loved ones home. There'll be no more sorrow when Jesus comes to gather his loved ones home. Good news for all of us. How has your week been? Good? Mediocre? Bad? Well, we're here to give you a little brightness, a little hope, a little joy, a little bit of the gospel, and a lot of inspiration. And this is what we do each and every week. I like to give a book review each week. I read vociferously. I'm reading all of the time. And a lot of times I'm reading books. I've read so many books in my life. This is one that I've read recently by Dr. Michael Satlow, who is a professor of religious studies at Brown University. It's entitled, How the Bible Became Holy. Isn't that an interesting title? How the Bible became holy. It wasn't always so. And so he begins right around 950 BC, when we are pretty sure that the first books of the Bible were written, during the time of the divided kingdom. You'll recall that Israel had a monarchy, three kings, Saul and David and Solomon. And then there was a division between the north and the south. And it was during that time of division that the first Bible books were probably written. The evidence strongly suggests that. I know some of you might be thinking, well, wait a second, Moses lived hundreds of years before that when he wrote Genesis through Deuteronomy. The evidence is very strong that Moses did not write those first five books of the Bible, that they were written much later, because we have names of places that didn't exist till much later after Moses lived. And we have the story, of course, in Deuteronomy of the death of Moses, which would have been pretty hard for Moses to write. And so Dr. Satlow, S-A-T-L-O-W, begins there and then goes along and shows you the trajectory of the different books of the Bible, and finally put together and then translated into Greek in a translation we call the Septuagint, about 200 years before Jesus was born. And it is about that time that this work called the Bible, or actually the Hebrew Bible at that time, becomes a sacred text. And then, of course, in the New Testament times, we have the writings of Paul and Peter and John and the gospel writers, and that is brought together by Christianity with the Hebrew text for what we call the Holy Bible. So Dr. Satlow has this wonderful book describing the holiness of the Bible, how it became holy over time, how the Bible became holy, by Michael Satlow. I think this is a book you would enjoy reading, and it would add to your religious education. And so we continue on in our journey. Each and every week I like to mention names of people in our church family and ancillary to our church family, names of people who are loved ones of yours that you've given me that you'd like me to remember or mention each week because they're watching from other parts of the country. So when we began doing this, we sort of had a romper room experience where we would look into the magic mirror and mention the names, and so I'm going to mention the names as I look into my Tierra Santa magic mirror today. So follow along with me. Perhaps you'll hear your name today. Here we go. I see Steve and Mike and Janine and Dawn, D-A-W-N, and Crystal and Haley. I see Neil and Brooke and Elise and Lucas. I see Raymond and Peggy and Jesus and Shireen and Priyanka and Lakshmi. I see Maria and Peter and Kelly and Peter II and Kendall and Avery. I see Kara and Eric and Rodica and Chris. I see Sandra and Reese and John and Susan and Marty. I see Linda and Daniel and Ed. I see Georgina and Anthony and Paul and Candace and Ryan. Thank you all for watching each week and for being a part of our church at Tierra Santa, and for your continued financial gifts which keep our church going. We are hoping sometime within the next 2 to 3 months to be back to normal worship in the sanctuary. We continue to meet right now in the courtyard. We call it Church in the Courtyard at 10 in the morning. We'll be giving you more updates about that as we go along. But we're hoping to get back to normal sometime in the next 3 months. And hopefully this will occur. The pandemic seems to be slowly winding down in the world, and certainly in the United States, as more and more people get vaccinated. We are developing something of what is called a herd immunity. It will take time. We've had over 500,000 people die in the last year here in the United States from the COVID virus. And we pray for all of those families who have lost loved ones. So now I would like to pray before we have our sermon for today. and let us bow our heads and pause and talk to God. We thank you, our Heavenly Parent, for life itself. Life is so precious. We've been reminded of this during the last year in a special way. We have lost some loved ones here in our Tierra Santa Church family, and we pray for those surviving family members of these loved ones. We also pray for those who are hurting, those who are feeling depression. We ask you to please comfort them and give them a semblance of your joy and peace. We have been looking through the Bible over the last year, beginning right with the beginning text of the Bible. And we ask that you will give us continued insight as we journey with the Israelites and learn things from them. So bless us now as we open your word in Jesus' name. Amen. I've enjoyed these fireside chats next to the fire. It's something that is meaningful to me, hopefully meaningful to you. The title of today's sermon is Prophets Are Human Too. Prophets are human too. We began almost a year ago by starting with Genesis 1 and going through the story chronologically of the Bible, beginning right there with the creation of the world. Some of you can keep this chronology in your mind. Some of you are learning it for the first time. So we begin with the story of the creation of the world, and then we have the story of Adam and Eve, the story of their children Cain and Abel and Seth, and then the story of Noah and the flood, and then the great story of the Tower of Babel. And then we move along in Genesis 12 to the beginning of the story of Abraham, and then his son Isaac, his son Jacob, all of his sons, and Joseph is the one that's focused on. And then you have a period of roughly 400 years of the descendants of Jacob living in Egypt and then becoming indentured servants or slaves to the Pharaohs. And then we have the story of Moses and then the exodus of these people from Egypt into the Sinai Peninsula, where they wander for 40 years. And then they enter into the Promised Land under the leadership of Caleb and Joshua. And their existence for the next few decades is under the auspices of and the leadership of what are called judges. And that's where we find ourselves now. Last week we looked at the story of Ruth, a story that occurs during the time of the judges. There is no king of Israel yet. They are just a loose collection of tribes, of the 12 tribes of Israel. They constantly have skirmishes with the other peoples around them, different Canaanite tribes and groups. That's where we arrive at today. And we're missing something. Something has been missing from this whole story so far that I want to focus on today. And what has been missing is a great prophet. There are no prophets mentioned yet. Isn't that interesting that we have gone many, many centuries without a prophet being mentioned? But now we come to 1 Samuel, and we will come to the first great prophet in Israel. If you have a Bible, I'd like you to take it and turn to 1 Samuel chapter 1. If you don't have a Bible handy, you can listen closely. I'm going to be reading 1 Samuel chapter 1 and just reading on and making comments as the story goes along. But this is how the story, the beginning of the first prophet in Israel, begins. 1 Samuel chapter 1. There was a certain man from Ramathaim. Ramathaim is another name for the town of Ramah, R-A-M-A-H, and that will appear as Ramah throughout the story, never again Ramathaim. But there's a certain man, and his name is Elkanah, the son of Jeroram, the son of Elihu, the son of Tohu, the son of Zuph, an Ephraimite. He had two wives, this man, Elkanah. One was called Hannah, and the other Penina. Penina had children, but Hannah had none. This is a familiar account. Remember, Abraham's wife Sarah had no children, couldn't have children. So Elkanah has two wives. One of them is named Hannah. The other one is Penina. Penina has children, many of them, and Hannah has none. Year after year, this man went up from his town to worship and sacrifice to the Lord Almighty at Shiloh. Shiloh is the place where the tabernacle had been set up after they moved into the land of Canaan. And that is where the Ark of the Covenant was, in Shiloh. So every year, Elkanah would take his wives and all of his children, and he would go up to Shiloh to worship the Lord. There were two priests who were in charge of the tabernacle there. Their names were Hophni and Phinehas. They were the two sons of Eli. He was the high priest at the time. Verse 4, whenever the day came for Elkanah to sacrifice, he would give portions of the meat that he offered as sacrifice to his wife Penina and to all her sons and daughters. But to Hannah, he gave a double portion because he loved her. And the Lord had closed her womb. This is another way of saying she was childless. She couldn't have children. And because the Lord had closed her womb, her rival, that is Penina, kept provoking her in order to irritate her. This went on year after year. Whenever Hannah went up to the house of the Lord, her rival provoked her till she wept and would not eat. Elkanah, her husband, would say to her, "Hannah, why are you weeping? Why don't you eat? Why are you downhearted? Don't I mean more to you than 10 sons?" And the answer, of course, from Hannah's perspective is no. You do not mean more to me than 10 sons. I need a child. That's what gave women in those days status and self-esteem. I need a son. Once when they had finished eating and drinking in Shiloh, Hannah stood up. Now Eli, the priest, was sitting on a chair by the doorpost of the Lord's tabernacle. And in bitterness of soul, Hannah wept much and prayed to the Lord. And she made a vow, saying, "O Lord Almighty, if you will only look upon your servant's misery and remember me and not forget your servant, but give her a son, then I will give him to the Lord for all the days of his life, and no razor will ever be used on his head." This is a vow that she's making. If she has a son, she will dedicate him to Yahweh for the rest of his life. As she kept on praying to the Lord, this is verse 12, as she kept on praying to the Lord, Eli observed her mouth. Hannah was praying in her heart, and her lips were moving, but her voice was not heard, and Eli thought she was drunk. You can imagine. And so he said to her, "How long will you keep on getting drunk? Get rid of your wine." In verse 15, she says, "Not so, my Lord. I'm a woman who is deeply troubled. I have not been drinking wine or beer. I was pouring out my soul to the Lord. Do not take your servant for a wicked woman. I've been praying here out of the great anguish and grief of my heart." Eli answered, "Go in peace, and may the God of Israel grant you what you have asked of him." Oh, this is wonderful. The priest, the high priest, Eli, says, "May God grant this to you." And so in the course of time, Hannah has a son. The Lord answers her prayer. Eli has said, "May the God of Israel answer your prayer." And she names him Samuel. And the word Samuel means or sounds something like the Hebrew word for heard of God. And so she weans Samuel. And when she has weaned him, he's about 3 years old. She takes him back to Shiloh, to the tabernacle with Elkanah and Penina. And she dedicates him to God and tells Eli, "I'm the woman who a few years ago you thought was drunk. And then you blessed me. And I have been blessed, and God has given me a son. His name is Samuel, and now I give him to you. And she was so happy. The second chapter is a great song and prayer of Hannah to the Lord in her great joy and happiness that she's had this boy. And so Samuel is going to live there with Eli and with Eli's sons, Hophni and Phinehas. And each year, Hannah comes back during the time to worship Yahweh at Shiloh, and she brings a little robe for Samuel. So each year he has a new robe as he's growing up. Eventually, Hannah has more children. We read in chapter 2, verse 21, that the Lord is gracious to her, and she has three sons and two daughters. And meanwhile, Samuel continues to grow in grace and in stature. Well, one night while Eli was sleeping and Samuel was trying to sleep, he hears a voice. Samuel hears a voice that says, "Samuel, Samuel." And he thinks, Samuel thinks that it's Eli. And so he runs into Eli and wakes him up and says, "Yes, what do you want?" And Eli says, "I didn't call for you. Go back to sleep." And so Samuel goes back to sleep, and then he hears the voice again, "Samuel, Samuel." He runs to Eli. "What do you want, Eli, my master?" Eli says, "I didn't call you. Go back to sleep." This happens again. And after the third time, Eli says, "I think Yahweh is trying to speak to you. So the next time you hear the voice, say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" And so, sure enough, Samuel hears the voice again, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel says, "Speak, your Lord, Yahweh, for your servant is listening." And Yahweh, the God of Israel, says to Samuel, "I have called you to be my servant, and I have a message for Eli. His sons are very wicked, and Eli's house is going to come to an end because he has not been raising his sons correctly." And so Samuel has to tell this terrible news to Eli. He tells this to Eli, and Eli says, "May it be as the Lord has said." Eli is very sad, but he has not been raising his sons correctly. And so one day, the Philistines attack the Israelites, and they come to Shiloh, and they steal the Ark of God, and they kill Eli's sons, Hophni and Phinehas. And a servant runs and tells Eli, "The ark has been stolen, and your sons, Hophni and Phinehas, have been killed." And Eli falls off the back of the stool that he's been sitting on and breaks his neck and dies. And that is the end of the house of Eli. It is a sad tale. And then Samuel grows up and becomes the prophet in Israel. And he judges. He actually makes decisions regarding different legal matters in Israel, and for a long time, he judges Israel. Samuel has two sons also. Their names, as we read in chapter 8, are Joel and Abijah. But the text tells us that his sons did not walk in his ways. His sons also were not raised correctly. And so the people come to Samuel when he's old, and they say in verse 5, "You are old, and your sons do not walk in your ways. Now appoint a king to lead us." Samuel is heartbroken that they've asked for a king. God said they're never to have a king, but they've asked for a king. And the reason they've asked for a king is because Samuel's sons are so wicked. Samuel says, "But my sons are leading you." And they say, but "Your two sons are awful people. They accept bribes, and they do not judge fairly. They do not judge justly." And Samuel can't see this. He's blinded to the evil of his own sons. And so Samuel's very defensive. He gets very angry. And as he's nearing the end of his life, they have demanded a king. Now, we're getting ahead of ourselves a little bit here, and next week we will look at the beginning of King Saul's life. But as Samuel gets to the end of his life, he confronts all of the people, and he insists that they have been evil people by asking for a king. even though it's because of his own sons that they have asked for a king. He cannot see the flaws in his own life, the way that he has pampered his own sons and tolerated their wickedness. You see, prophets are human, all of them. All prophets make mistakes because they're people. Prophets are human too. Many of us growing up in the Seventh-day Adventist Church were under the impression that our prophet, the person who raised this church up, Ellen White, was perfect and never made a mistake. None of her writings have any errors in them. We cannot reckon with the fact that prophets are people too. It's so difficult for us. And as we've learned, some of the flaws in Ellen White's own life and some of the mistakes that she has made in some of her own writings, it's impossible to grapple with it. We refuse to believe it. But prophets are people too. Pastors are people too. Your greatest heroes are human. As Abraham Lincoln once said in one of his inaugural addresses, we are not angels. We are not angels. We are human. And we need to remember that. So the first great prophet in Israel's history, Samuel, had his good points, but he also had his flaws. And we need to realize this and keep this perspective in mind and realize that God has called us to be his servants, to share the good news of the gospel, but it will be in flawed vessels. God trusts these flawed vessels enough to give us this life-saving message. Aren't you glad that even in the midst of our faults, in the midst of our imperfection, God still thinks enough of us to give us this wonderful message that we can share with the world that God is love. Let us bow our heads for prayer. Our heavenly parent, may we never forget we are all less than perfect. We are all human. We are not angels, but we can still be effective messengers for you with a life-saving message. These things I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I hope that you have a magnificent week this week as we journey on and that we remain thankful to God for all of his wonderful gifts. And so until next week, thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole. Thank you, Lord, for giving to me thy great salvation so rich and free.